Hi guys, welcome back to the Zeze Millz Show. I was just having a chat with my guest. This is a little bit, how do you say that word? Nostalgia. Yeah, this is a bit like, it feels, that's
nostalgic.
Yes, there we go. Nostalgic because we have Ashley Waters in front of me. Does anyone actually call you Asher D anymore?
Old people.
Oh, I was going to call you Asher D, so I'm not going to do that because I'm not old, I'm young still, yeah. But that's what I know you as.
Yeah.
I know you as Asher D. And then as you switched over to the acting, you do Ashley Waters. So this is like, I was saying to my production manager that I think I've only been a little bit, I wouldn't say nervous. Nervous is a very strong word. A little bit like, ooh, kind of.
You did say nervous.
Yeah, I did, but...
Well, I'm don't gonna, need to hurt you
I'm gonna like, I'm thinking it's not nerves, it's more like a, oh, this is a bit surreal.
Yeah.
Because, as I said, I grew up on Asher D. I'm talking about you like you're not here. I grew up on Asher D. And like, I think most girls, we had crushes, we had a crush on Asher D, Ashley Waters.
Okay.
I would say, like, no disrespect to your lovely wife or anything like that. Like, we all had crushes. I had a crush on, I was like, oh, I came to do a... I feel like we've crossed paths loads of times because I came to read for something that you done.
What was that?
I can't remember, but it was at your drama school and it was like a series that you was gonna start doing.
Oh, Charlatans.
Yes, yeah. And I came and I did like an audition for that.
Wow.
And then I think that's the only thing really I auditioned for. And I think I auditioned for your drama school as well.
Okay.
I didn't get into any of those. So guys, the moral of the story is they will reject you, but one day they'll be sitting across the table from you, you know, and grill them to death.
I'm cool. But you know what the mad thing about it is? We pretty much accept everyone. So I don't know what you did to not get in, but everyone gets in.
Maybe it wasn't the school. No, it was definitely, we definitely, no, I think I did.
It weren't my school.
No, I think it was, but I definitely did the Charlatans. I remember that because I had to send a tape in and then I remember, that's when I was doing my acting thing and it was safe. But what I didn't know is that you went to Sylvia Young Theatre School.
Yeah, that's right.
So did I.
Did you?
Yes.
Did you go to the one on Rossmore Road?
Yes,
okay,
I did.
Cool.
I went full time. I was
wow.
The proper like...
Buffing.
Yeah, like stage school brat. You know, like...
Mummy and daddy had money.
Just mum. Dad. We don't know about that one. But yeah. Oh God, I hope he doesn't see this. Anyway, he seems to watch stuff here and there. Did you like Sylvia's? You went Saturday school.
Yeah, I went Saturdays and... Nah, if I'm honest with you...
You didn't like it?
I didn't like it because other people didn't like it. And I was too young to really kind of have my own mind back then. So it was like, it was a secret.
Oh, that you went there?
Yeah, I didn't really talk about it, so.
Because most people went Anna Shears. I feel like acting people, like black acting people in our world, they all went Anna Shears, not really Sylvia Young. And there's always this thing of like Sylvia's against Anna Shears and Natalia Conte. I don't think anyone's going to care about
I think Sylvia one day probably won't. I think Sylvia's out of the three of them was a bit more posh.
Yeah, it was prestige. If you got into Sylvia's, that's what I'm saying. You didn't let me into Kingdom School, but I got into Sylvia's. So what happened
there? There you go. We lost. We lost out.
It's fine. Don't worry about it. Anyway, thank you for coming on.
No problem. Thank you for having me, man.
How's COVID been treating you?
Difficult.
Has it been? You have 8 children.
I have 8 children, yeah.
And how many of those 8 live with you?
2 now.
Okay, cool. So it wasn't like I was just imagining a house full of 8 kids during COVID.
I mean, they pass through enough and my phone rings enough from them. But I think I've got like 4 quite... big ones. My oldest is nearly 21.
Okay.
I have a 19-year-old daughter, going on 20, a 19-year-old son, and a 17-year-old son going on 18, so.
Do they, are the older ones,
the problem, yeah.
Not a problem, but are they proud of you?
Sorry, kids.
The proud of you sounds a bit cliche, but do they look at you and just be like, wow, like, my dad's in top
grade,
my dad's,
you know,
like, they don't care.
Nah, they don't care. I think the older ones, especially because, first of all, like, they were there in the beginning when it was a struggle, when I was kind of still out there a bit, loose-minded and went to prison and whatever. So I think what they kind of felt from my career at that point mainly was the fact that it took me away from them.
Right, okay.
So I had a lot of issues. You know, I remember like filming in South Africa and then coming home for a week and then having to go back and my son chasing the cab. Do you know what I mean? And me watching through the back window like it was a movie or something. But, you know, if those are your experiences, they kind of imprint on your mind. So a lot of the time when, like, I was watching, you know, first series of Top Boy would come on and we'd all sit down, whatever, in the front room, and I'd be like, everyone come. They wouldn't come. They don't want to watch it. So they stayed away from me. But the reality is, listen, nothing's perfect. Sometimes we fall out. I class myself as, in the mind and inside, I'm a young person. Do you know what I'm saying? And I feel like the generational gap between, you know, parents and kids these days and the understanding of what's going on in our environment or around us these days is a lot smaller than it was before. So a lot of the stuff they know, I know. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
a lot
of
the music they listen to, I listen to. A lot of the films they watch, I will watch. So we clash a lot.
So how did you rebuild that relationship, though, if they kind of were not really, they didn't really care? Is it better now? They understand it more as they get older. They understand that, oh, it's like me, certain things my mum might have done when I was younger, I'd be like, oh. And as I've got older, I'd be like, oh, okay, makes sense. Now that's why she done it, or now that's why it happened. Do you think that?
I don't think they're at that stage yet. I think they still hold a lot against me. And they're still young at the end of the day, really. I treat them like adults, but they're still very young, so they've got a lot to learn. And, you know, like I said, it's never been perfect. We clash a lot. Sometimes I don't want to talk to my son. Do you know what I mean? He don't want to talk to me and whatever. And, like, it's life, man. It's life.
So when would you say you actually came on to the scene? So I know you from, obviously, So Solid Crew.
Mm-hmm.
But you've done stuff before that, right? But would you say So Solid Crew is the thing that put you out there?
Yeah, 100%. I'd say it was a big part of the journey in the sense that it made me kind of more of a household name in a sense that Soul Solid was a household name and I was part of that collective. So kind of it put me on the map in that sense. And I think it made people look at my past as well.
I didn't realise that you wasn't a part of the initial So Solid crew in the beginning. How did that happen?
I was just a fan of music, of garage music, and I was listening to pirate radio on a daily basis after school, writing lyrics. And there came an opportunity where I think it was Mega that was doing some live calling or something on Delight FM pirate radio. And I called in, actually it was Supreme, and I called in, spat some lyrics down the phone. He was like, yeah, it's dope. And then a few weeks later, I was at the studio. And I just went from there.
Would you say everything happened quite quickly with So Solid? As in?
It's a complete blur. Complete blur.
Seriously?
Yeah, I don't even remember any of it.
Why don't you remember it? Because of the excitement or because?
Because of the excitement, because.
The lifestyle.
Just not realising, you know, you have to cherish the moments that were happening. Maybe some of it was about taking it for granted as well, what I had.
Because I feel like you done 21 seconds and then there was, it's gone out of my head now. What's it?
They Don't Know.
Yes.
Yeah.
And then to me, after that, mate, I could be wrong, then it kind of just went quiet after that.
Yeah, it did.
So what happened? Was there just too many people?
It's called Police.
Oh, right.
People started going to prison. People started getting shot at our raves. A couple people died at our raves. So they felt that we were inciting violence with our lyrics. You know, they were talking about us in House of Parliament. And then I just remember being on tour, going on our UK tour, our first UK tour. And one by one, we were on our way to venues, the next venue, and they'd be cancelling while we were on our way. You know what I'm saying? And literally, like, the government and the police were just like, we ain't having it.
When you look back now, do you feel like maybe the lyrics and your music did incite violence?
I mean, maybe slightly, yeah. All right, well, listen, let me give the right answer. Yes, they did. But it wasn't our intention for it to be that way. We definitely were of the understanding and of, you know, trying to empower ourselves. But more importantly, like, we used to call ourselves correspondents.
Right.
Like, that was the terminology for the members of the crew. And what our aim was to do was to talk about things that weren't being spoken about like they are today on social media. We didn't have that platform to talk about stuff that goes on. Our only voice was through music.
Yeah.
You couldn't trust the 10 o'clock news to be talking about exactly about what was happening where we were. So I think if people listen maybe a bit deeper, there was a bit of bravado and, you know, gun talk and this and that, but a lot of it was kind of politically aimed at, like, you know, pushing us forward or opening people's minds or inciting some sort of revolution. And I think we kind of did that with music anyway.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think anyone can not remember when 21 Seconds came out. Like, even now, when 21 Seconds comes on at a rave, it still, like, pops off. And as a girl, you're waiting for Lisa Mafia's part so you can, like, sing along. It's so, when it comes on, it's just like, oh my God, this was a sick time I was in school. Was the lifestyle, going back to the lifestyle, is that the reason why you was carrying a gun around? Did you ever feel threatened about...
I was threatened on probably a daily basis, man, really. It was like I was a fish out of water. Remember, I was like this theatre school trained kid.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, doing acting, tap, ballet, you know, them sort of things on a Saturday at Sylvia's, and then kind of found music, joined this crew that was a group of roadmen. Like, they were really about that life, a lot of them. And a lot of them became my friends. A lot of them became my father figure. You know what I'm saying? So I was heavily influenced by that. And that's not me trying to blame them, but, you know, that was the scenario. But what also came with it was I inherited their beef. Mm. You know, a lot of people's beef. I moved in with my partner at the time. She was pregnant. I was 17 years old, and I moved in with her in Brixton. Nonchalant, you know, not understanding where I was, you know what I mean, what the area was about at that time. And a lot of the problems stemmed from that. So I was undergoing, like, mad pressure, like, serious stuff from serious people. And I guess I just came to the conclusion that I should do what everyone else is doing around me, man.
Do you think that's another thing that kind of was happening in today with the young musicians today, that a lot of them are coming from the roads and then they're making that transition into music, but they still have unfinished beef, they still have stuff that they haven't sorted out before? So doing the crossover, so it's kind of like they've got one foot in, one foot out, and then that's why they also get arrested for carrying a knife or something that's happened. Do you think that's the problem that is happening in now? Like, how easy is it to switch from the roads and then kind of into the straight and narrow, but then you still got those enemies?
Listen, it's difficult. I've seen the process, and I'd say it's one of the most difficult things to do, but I think if you want to have a successful career and change your life, you know, you have to make that leap. You can't be half-hearted about it. So that one foot in, one foot out thing just ain't gonna work. And we see it now with a lot of our favorite artists today, you know, in and out of prison and dealing with that or whatever. But the fact of the matter is, I mean, I suppose as a society today, we enable it.
Yeah,
when I was going to prison, it was like, no one didn't want, I put out an album when I was in prison, no one heard it.
Because that's what
now, no,
if you did,
that would be gone.
100%.
Do you know what I mean? So
that's what I was saying to someone today, because I was saying, I remember when the news came out that you got found with a gun and you was going to prison. It was like, oh, that's it. That's it, man, his career's over. Nowadays, it's like, if you go to prison, it's like, wow, boy, this is good for him, because everyone's gonna be waiting for him to come out of prison, or what's he gonna say? He might even do a live in prison, who knows? You know, if he gets the phone, he might be able to do that. But in that era, it was kind of like, that was it. So I think when you came out of prison and then you kind of made the transition into acting, how did you manage to do that?
I gave up. I gave up everything.
What do you mean?
I stripped myself of the persona that I had before I went in.
Okay.
I talked about my past. I became more open in interviews, you know what I mean, about what my life was really about. I spent a lot of time trying to convince people that I wasn't really dangerous. What you got to understand is, like, you know, even going into acting, when I first started acting, I think maybe when I was doing Bullet Boy, after I come out of jail, people were shook to work with me. Because just imagine, they've been just bombarded with images of me in that fisherman's hat on the front page of the news or whatever, and like gun-toting gangster, those sort of headlines or whatever it was. And then, you know, you get onto set with a bunch of middle-class white people that don't really know that life or whatever. They're expecting you to go, you know what I'm saying, or whatever, you see? Even you, Joe. You see what I'm saying? So, and the fact is, I weren't brought up like that. You know, so it's just about stripping myself of all that and kind of putting people at ease when they were around me and kind of letting them know that I can articulate myself. I can rap with you. I can, you know what I mean? Do certain things or whatever that maybe they didn't think I had the ability to do. And that's kind of what got me there. To stand on stage and get my award at the Biffers when I got my award for Bullet Boy, that was the most emotional part of that moment. It wasn't even about the physical thing, it was just about the fact that these people were accepting me when I was sitting in that prison cell thinking, it's done. What have I done? Do you know what I mean?
I think obviously Bullet Boy was good, but the scene that I remember was the sex scene. I couldn't believe it. Like, that was probably in British films. We had urban British films, but we never got to see like the nitty gritty sex scenes, scenes like in Hollywood films. What was that like? I really want to know. Because your bum was like really on camera. Everything was there. Do you know what I mean?
My bum's been on camera a few times now.
I know, but that was proper like, yeah, and no, I feel like, what was that like? Just tell me.
It was good. It was good times. Good fun. Good fun. I don't want to offend anyone. Hello, Sharia. Sharia Samuels. But yeah, it was good. It was good fun. I was working with some good actors, some good people. I think at that point as well, though, I may have been slightly nervous about it, about doing it. And we had a lot of preparation for it. Mm. Not practice, but prep, you know.
Difference, guys.
Yeah. for it, kind of in the lead up. And I think Sharia was very, she was just very cool about it all. So it kind of put me at ease, so to speak.
You was also like one of the first people to do the crossover, because you did that film and then you kind of just weirdly, not randomly, but then you did Get Rich or Die Trying. And again, everyone was just like, how did you manage to do that? How did you manage to do crossover to the American scene and be in like, that was a really big film as well. How did that all come about?
Being at the right place, right time, and just kind of, I suppose, putting my head down and making sure I did my best work as much as I could, because that was solely off the back of Bullet Boy, that film.
Really?
The director is from the UK or Ireland. And he'd seen Bullet Boy doing the festival scene and whatever, and wanted to bring some UK talent into that movie. And he hit me up, or he had my agent. And I don't think they were going to go with me in the beginning. You know, if I think about it now, in hindsight, I feel like it took nearly a year for them to call me back.
Oh, wow.
And let me know I had that part, which is so unusual. It's like, I'd done forgotten about it,
yeah,
do you know what
I
mean?
I was
like, I never got that. But yeah, they called me and it was like, it was random. It was like midnight, my agent called me. She's like, pack your bag, you gotta go to Canada next week. And I was gone.
Would you prefer acting or music, if you had to pick? I feel like you've got, I'm gonna like answer the question for you, obviously you're gonna answer it. But my personal opinion is that I feel like you enjoy acting, but your passion is music. Or that's the thing that you kind of always go back to.
My passion is art.
Okay, fair
enough. Is creation. Like, I like creating something. So whether that be directing, or, do you know what I mean? Organizing an event, or, do you know what I mean? Something like that, I don't mind, but I just like creating stuff. But I suppose, you know, I'm definitely passionate about music, but what a lot of people probably don't know about me is that I don't like the process of acting.
Oh, you don't?
I really enjoy it.
What, the learning the lines, all of that, or?
Just like being on set for 14 hours a day and only maybe filming for two, and do you know what I mean? It's just, not to be rude, but it's a waste of my time. Do you know what I mean? It does help that you get paid well and handsomely, but yeah, the process of it, kind of letting someone else be in control of what you say, what you do, you know, letting the director control how you do something or whatever. It's hard for me sometimes.
Do you think that there's a place for you in music still? Or do you think maybe the young people look at you and think, because depending on how old you are, some people might only know you as Ashley Waters, the actor.
Listen, do you know what I think? Anything can happen. Like I, you know, there was a day where I felt like, Ash, just allow it, man. Do you know what I mean? Like, I sometimes doubt myself and I'm like, bruv, like, just leave it alone, man. Like, these kids are not feeling you. They're just not listening, bro. They're not listening. And then the other side of me will go, who gives a fuck? Who cares? I enjoy doing it. Let me just keep on doing it. I'm not doing it for money anymore. I'm not, you know what I mean? I'm not.
But you just recently signed a publishing deal with, so what's that about?
Well, I signed a publishing deal.
Yeah, but what are you, yeah, well, what's the, how does
well,
this work?
I write.
So you're going to write for other people or write for yourself?
I might already do that. You don't know.
Because, okay, fair enough.
Well, I mean, listen, it was COVID. If you look, no one was getting no deals throughout COVID because no one ain't spending no money. But Warner Chappell took a chance on me, so I must have showed them something that they're interested in. Do you know what I'm saying?
Well, I'm interested to
well,
to see.
Listen, there's stuff coming out. I'm not gonna lie, and we'll see how it goes. I don't want to talk it up because the reality is, who knows if there's a market for it? Who knows how many people are gonna be interested in it? But I know that I have a dying passion to have a solo career, and I'm one of those people. Like, if I want something, I go ham for it. You know what I'm saying?
So, do you feel like your solo career has never taken off properly?
Well, I've never had one.
But you have released a couple albums, though.
Yeah, but it's not a solo career. A solo career is people knowing your music, or a good enough amount of people knowing your music, understanding you as an artist, wanting to hear more of what you've got coming. And don't get me wrong, there's some ride or die people that are out there that are still, you know, riding with me and still support me or whatever, but I suppose I want that to happen on more of a mass scale. But I also have to understand my lane. A lot of the producers that I'm working with now, like new producers that are producing for people today, a lot of the time in the beginning, they don't even want to work with me. Or I'll turn up in their studio and they'll be like, bruv, I'm not even, do you know what I mean? Like,
well, they actually say it's your own.
Yeah, people will be honest, like, well, I don't even know what Ashley Waters' track is going to sound like, you know? I don't even know if I want to hear it or whatever, but I'm here for all of that. I'm here for art. I'm here to create. I'm here to find a way. And I think I've found
your
the
sound.
Way. Well, I found the way.
Okay. I found the way. I'm interested to hear what the sound. I think it's going to be, like, more spoken word.
Nah.
Not, like, more smooth. I heard some stuff that you had on your Instagram.
Yeah.
And there was like more singing vibe
but,
type of thing.
A lot of that stuff is stuff I've been writing for other people.
Okay, fair enough.
A lot of my own stuff people haven't heard yet.
So, Top Boy. Yeah. We all loved it. Came out first season. It was like, the first time it came out, it was only like 3 nights or 4 nights, wasn't it, on Channel 4? It wasn't like a, it came out.
Yeah, it was 4 nights in a row.
It was 4 nights in a row. And then the second season came out. And then it got, did it get dropped by Channel 4 or Channel 4 just didn't want to do it anymore? Well, I'm surprised at that because it had such a good reaction and everybody loved it. So I'm surprised that they didn't want to continue it. What happened there?
I mean, there could be various reasons. I have not been privy to the actual reason why it happened. And every time I ask, you know, the rest of the producers on the show, they're like, don't go there or we don't know ourselves or whatever. But if I took a long shot, probably what happened was, and it usually happens in big corporations like Channel 4, a new person came in and took over. Okay. The drama commissioning side of things, and usually what they want to do is make a mark for themselves. They don't want to have the other person's show that was big. Do you know what I mean?
You have a commission
that show and it was big or whatever. So I think we were the most prominent to be axed at that point. And then there was a backlash as well. It weren't smooth sailing for us.
Yeah.
There was a lot of parents out there, you know, black parents protesting against the show.
I mean, obviously then it came to Netflix and I spoke about it on my show. So now you're here, it's a perfect discussion to have. I spoke about it on my show and I said, you know what? I liked Top Boy the first two seasons, but the third one that's coming out now on Netflix or however they've done it as a new thing on Netflix, I was kind of like, I'm kind of over this narrative. I'm over the narrative of drug dealers, guns, black boys, impoverished, nothing going on, but they can only sell drugs to make it out of the hood. And I said, I just don't know if I want to watch it. One thing I did say, I liked the casting. I liked that you used known people and then they didn't use people that were new talent. I liked that. And then I thought, you know what, before I speak, or I've spoken, but let me watch it and let me see what I actually think about it. And I watched it, and I watched it, turned it on with a very skeptical mind of, I'm not going to like this because I know what this is going to be about. But I was pleasantly surprised because I liked, you still had the narrative of the drug dealer thing, which I think sometimes is over perpetuated in our content. And I feel like there needs to be other stuff out there. But I enjoyed the fact that you showed different types of black people. So with the girl that the guy was going, I can't remember the name, you know, she came from a two-parent family. Her family had a really good job. And then you touched on the mental health issues and all of those type of things. So I liked the variety, but I do understand that I do understand why parents would be annoyed with it, because I do feel like these type of dramas do perpetuate this idea that black boys only know how to do drugs and kill each other. Agree or no?
I agree with it. Listen, I'm a narrative creator. So I sincerely agree in the fact that we all, as writers, as directors, black, I mean, yeah, writers, directors, creators, producers, we need to be changing the narrative, or we need to be definitely making different, telling different stories. But then you have, on the other hand, just like in music, some people won't want to listen to it, or the masses won't want to listen to it because it's what people are into, which isn't an excuse. But I guess what we try to do with Top Boy, or what we try and do, is, like you said, add to the fire social issues, you know, real social issues. I think a lot of the other shows you see, or films you see, that go down that narrative are quite two-dimensional and dehumanize the protagonists a lot of the time, whereas I think that we make them human. And if you can see, like, you know, Michael, Jamie, with his brothers at home, and that, you know, that narrative or whatever, you know, we're very much up on showing black love. We are very specific about having scenes with them boys lying on each other, hugging each other, you know, being tactile with each other, in order to show people that these people are human and there is a reason why they are in that place, whether it's a mental thing, you know what I mean, it's mental health or necessity or bad influence or whatever, but everyone's there for a reason, and it's just about trying to get society to see that a bit more. But at the same time, we are not a documentary. We're not a, you know, we're not there for that. We are there to entertain people, yeah, as a TV show. And I think we do well with it, but I think it serves best for us to serve the community in the best way we can with that narrative, if you get what I'm saying. It's a very long-winded answer.
Yeah, I got you.
But there's a point.
So how did the whole Drake thing come about? I mean, when I heard that he wanted to do it, I mean, I have this like love-hate relationship with Drake. Not that he knows me or I know him personally, so it's not really a love-hate relationship. But sometimes I do have this feeling of like, did we really need that? Did we need someone from the US to come over and kind of like save the day? Do you get what I mean?
My talk is that we did, you know?
You think we really did?
I don't think I know. Like, we did. Like, that show, I was literally for like 6 years calling up the producers going, are you mad? Like, look at my Twitter. Look at my Twitter, like 100 and something messages a day or whatever. I'm getting Top Boy, Top Boy, Top Boy, Top Boy. And this is like 6 years after it was on and got cancelled.
Yeah.
So I'm like, there's a market for this. There's people
who
want
it.
There's an 11-year gap.
Oh my
God. Are you crazy? It's 11 years.
It doesn't feel, like, even when I was doing some research then, I was like, rah, 21 Seconds came out like time ago.
Yeah.
Like, I was young then. Anyway, sorry, back to your story.
No. So, yeah, so it weren't coming back. And I was calling these guys like, come on, man. Come on, make the show. And they were like, no, let's make something else. Let's work something else out, whatever, and then eventually, I think, when I saw Drake last time, because I got the story wrong. I thought he'd seen it on Netflix, when Netflix put the Channel 4 seasons on. But actually, he said he was in studio making one of his albums. I don't know which one it was. and he was piecing it together on YouTube. He was getting clips on YouTube and piecing it together, and he watched the whole thing there while he was making an album. And that's when he said he just felt it. And he shouted, well, he didn't shout me actually, he just posted something one day, and I woke up and saw it. And then some people I know that knew his people, whatever, kind of put us in contact. Had a brief interaction with him and then started speaking to his manager. And we were talking about all different sorts of things, like how we could bring the show back. You know, I was giving them details of the people they needed to talk to and this and that, whatever. I think there was a brief talk about there being like a Top Boy Chicago or a Top Boy different, you know what I mean? Like, oh, whatever, okay. And all them things came about until, I think like a year later, they just hollered at us, Drake and Future, and we're like, Netflix want to do it, sort of thing. So it's actually, this whole thing is a Netflix US deal. It's not Netflix UK, and they kind of work separately. Right. You know what I'm saying? So you would think that Netflix UK would have bought the show, but it was Netflix US.
So how, when it came to selecting the actors, do you have involvement with that?
Because like, I have involvement to the point that, all right, and this is not meant to sound arrogant or whatever, but if I ain't really feeling someone being in it, then I'm going to say
it. I'm not working with them every day on set. Like, it's long for me. Like,
well, it's not even that. I'd never do it on a basis of something that had happened outside of the show. But sometimes I feel like it to be sensational, sometimes people just want to be sensational. Right. Sometimes you got a formula like, all right, Kano was sick.
Yeah.
So let's always put musicians in it.
Well, this is whatever, what I was going to say. Do you know what I'm saying? Sometimes I feel like, especially with UK stuff, there's actors out there. Like, I know how hard it is when doing acting and stuff, and drama school, you have a drama school, you know how hard it is for people. So then why don't they just say, okay, it's great that, you know, we've already got Ashdy, we've got Kano, we don't need any more, we don't need the days, we don't need any of that. We're just gonna find other young actors, fresh actors to put in this. To be, like I said, I think that the casting was really good. I like that you had people like Davin, because I understand how these things work. You need that pulling power. It's just how it works.
That's what I was just going to say to you. I was going to say, because obviously you are not just going to interview your school friends, are you?
True.
None of us don't really want to see you and your brethrens talk that we don't know if they're not.
True.
You know what I mean? Someone in the public eye. No disrespect to your friends. So you do have to have like that pull. And what me and Kane definitely try and do is engineer that we pick the right people for it. And I think like, we haven't lost yet. Mm. Do you know what I'm saying? Like with Sims,
yeah, dope, she's so good.
She fit in.
Yeah.
Dave, like blew it out of the water for me. That little piece of like what he had, do you know what I'm saying? He took it and ran with it. And if you
did, they have to go through the audition process?
Yeah, kind of. Like not necessarily audition, but read.
Okay, right.
Definitely come in and read before decisions were made.
Right.
You know, it's gonna sound corny and cliche, but if you listen to Sims's music, if you listen to Dave's music and you know them as people, you know they'd be able to do this job anyway, but not everyone can. Like, I'm not gonna lie, there's a lot of people that shout me about this show, like musicians.
I can imagine. What are you saying, Ashley? Yeah, you can get a little cameo, what are you saying?
And some of them, don't get it twisted, like I'm like, they're definitely people that I would push for if it keeps on going or whatever.
Are you still in contact with people from So Solid? Like, are you still all pals?
Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't say we're all like buddy-buddy pals in each other's house or whatever, but a lot of the clique are still really tight. Mm. But they were probably the main core. And a lot of them are family anyway.
Yeah.
So with Mega's brother, Swiss, Keish is their cousin. Do you know what I'm saying? So. And Dan the Man and Mac and all them, Face, they all grew up together. I speak to Face, I speak to Swiss probably more than everyone. Mega every now and again, Harvey.
Did you guys break up on bad terms? Was it like a mutual decision to break up?
Or we didn't have no choice. We didn't have no choice. Listen, if you're, really? It's still the same today. If you're an artist, look, do you know how many rappers are going broke throughout COVID?
Yeah, I know, because they ain't no. Okay, so you're basically saying, right, imagine that.
So if you can't tour, you ain't making no money. Do you know what I'm saying? If you can't tour, how are you going to grow your empire?
How many
and build?
Was in there? How many was in the crew?
And there was a lot of us.
Yeah, like, how did you lot spit that money?
Don't ask me. I just know that I got mine.
Because it must have been, how did it work? You had to be on the track to get the money.
Not necessarily. I think our whole plan was from the beginning. The whole reason why we made 21 Seconds was me and G sat down one day and we were like, we worked out that radio wanted a track that was 3:30, yeah? And there was 11 of us or something at that time in the crew. We divided that into 3:30 and it came up as 21 point something something seconds on the calculator. So we were like, everyone's got 21 seconds. There was no hook in the beginning. So what Keisha is singing as a hook, that was his verse. So everyone just had one verse, 21 seconds, you know what I'm saying? It developed into to that song when it got picked up by a label and whatever else. But our whole aim was, how can we make all 11 of us known at once rather than going through this whole process of your album comes out, then your album comes out, then whatever, do you know what I'm saying? So that's how the collective started. But the plan was that everyone should get solo deals, which started to happen. You know what I'm saying? But I was one of the first to get my solo record deal, so.
And then you've kind of just like taken off. Well, do you feel like people always mention that you're the one that's done the best?
Yeah, look, I hear that. And I hate to hear it, if I'm honest with you, because a lot of other people are doing well in their own right, they're doing. So it's a bit bad of anyone to really say that, but without knowing. But I suppose their stuff is not in the public eye. But I definitely understand that I've managed to maintain a level of presence in the industry and, what do they call it, reinvent myself.
Yeah, you have. Like, you've managed to stay quite relevant, which is really hard to do.
Look at why is your face like that?
Because it's hard. Do you know, it's hard.
You're disappointed.
No, I think it's amazing. But I'm just saying that you've managed to, like, you know, stay on trend, I would say. But it doesn't seem like a force. There's certain people that you're just like, mate, let it go. It's not happening for you anymore.
Is that how it goes?
We get it. You really enjoy music, but music is not enjoying you. So let's just leave it alone. Whereas you, it's not. I always feel like you're doing different things. Like, you're married now. How's that?
It's good.
Do you like...
It's good. I mean, listen, I love my wife.
Yeah, you always, like, show that you love her. It's nice. I think we don't have enough representation of that. Do you know what I mean? Like, the OGs in the scene with their women. Your OG, basically.
Thank you very much. Yeah. I'll take that. My heart is still open.
So it's like, you know, the olders, you know, showing that they love their woman and that they've settled down. And
like I said, with my kids, nothing's perfect. And I advise everyone not to just
get married. Wow.
No, I never said that. Get married if you're ready to get married, but not everything that you see on my Instagram, you know, that doesn't equate to what my life is the whole time. And I have to be, when I do interviews like this, I have to be honest about that, you know what I mean? So I won't go into details or nothing like that, but I've been married 7 years. We've had issues, you know what I mean? Things haven't always gone right, but I guess what it's the marriage is about, and if it lasts, you know, I just celebrated my in-laws' 40th wedding anniversary, and they renewed their vows like weekend just gone, and that was an emotional time, probably the best wedding I've ever been to, because, you know, the whole talk was, they were quite honest in their vows about life and you know what I mean, how much probably they wanted to not be with each other and whatever over that time because of this and that, but it's about sticking with something. I feel like in this day and age, no, no one's trying to be married right now.
No.
You youngins, yeah.
Well, I am. I'm not young anymore. I'm trying to get married, but no one wants to marry me. That's another episode, another story. Do you know what I mean?
Why do you think that is?
Because come on.
Intimidating.
I don't know if people think, do you think I'm intimidating?
I don't think, you're not intimidating
me. You're not going to be intimidated, are you? You're like a big grown man with like 8 kids. There's no way you're going. No, you're not. You're not going to be intimidated. I feel like you've been through too much. You're too chilled. You're chilled. Like, your whole aura is just like, yeah, it's just life, innit?
Not always like that.
Do you get what I'm saying? Or maybe my interviewing skills makes you feel relaxed.
Yeah, no, this is a good interview.
Oh, I'm glad.
I'm having the space and the ability to think about what I'm saying before I say it. A lot of the time, I'm a very open guy.
Right, okay.
I'm a very, like, open guy. And sometimes I say a bit too much, but this one is going well.
I'm waiting for you to say, no, I'm joking. What do you think about, before we wrap up, what do you think about the scene right now? What's your feeling of it?
I think it's vibrant. I think it's progressing. I think some of the music is great. But maybe this is attached to what you asked me before about myself. When it comes to do I think I should stop or whatever? I'm seeing people do it that shouldn't be doing it as well. Do you know what I'm saying? And it just, I ain't saying no names. Don't try and get me into no war. I'm 38. Yeah, I ain't got no time for people rolling up to my house and emptying
it. No, you just do a clash online.
No. I'm into all of that. I don't want the stress.
You have to drop 64 bars. You've got 24 hours to respond. Boom, let's do this.
I'm not into all of that. Them days are done. Me and Dizzy already done that, man. It's literally just about like it's inspiring to see that it is open, you know, and that you can... Even if everyone doesn't like your music, you can still be a crowd that, you know, you can cater for and that will support you, which is encouraging for people like me. So if you see a lot of the time when I post stuff, it's just more inspiration. It's just more like, don't give up. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? If you really believe in yourself, actually, but also listen to people though around you. I play my music to everyone, from my mum to my kids, to random people, to other friends I know, you know what I mean? And try and get an opinion. And most people will tell me when something's shit or not, but I think, you know what I mean? I have to take that into consideration. So I wouldn't say to blindly keep going and wasting your money doing stuff. If everyone's telling you that all your stuff is dead, then you might have to listen. But, you know what I mean? If you know that you got something and it's moving and it's progressing, no matter how slow, keep doing it. And there's artists out there that inspire me that do that a lot. Like, probably I would say, like, as an example, I probably could say loads, but like Clue, for me, you know Clue.
Yeah.
Why are you making your face like that?
Because we're not best of pals.
Oh, you're not?
He always tries to come for me all the time.
Oh, for real? Yeah. I didn't even know that. Yeah. That's so mad. I'm like blindly intelligent. I just brought that up. Out of all the people I could have said, I said the guy that.
Yeah.
You're beefing
do you think he's good?
Yeah, I do, yeah. Wow. I think he's got something. I 100% think he's got something. And I think sometimes it's not your time because there's blockages.
Fair enough. Or maybe you're just not good.
Well, I mean, we each have our own opinion.
Have you got any questions that you want to ask me?
No.
You don't have no questions for me?
No.
Really?
I didn't know I was meant to. Otherwise, I would have brought a whole load.
You can have like one question off the top of your head. You
all right, so let's get back into this then. So if I called your agent or your people, who's your people? Which one is your...
Well, I've got
your
manager.
Your rep or your manager.
Yeah.
And was like, I want Zeze in this movie. What'd you do? Would you come and cast for it? Are you done with
it? It depends.
You're making too much money.
No, I'm not. It depends. It all depends. It depends how strenuous the audition process is as well. If I've got to come in and read and then come back again and then again. And then every time I come in, you guys build me up like, yeah, Z, that was amazing. So what are we going to do? We're going to come back in next week, give you a new script. And then you get excited like, oh yeah, this is coming. And then you don't get the role. I can't take that heartbreak anymore, actually. It's just too much.
So it's a wrap then?
No, I mean, if the money was right and it was a nice role, then never say no, never say never. Do you get what I mean? If I get to have like a nice kissing scene with a handsome guy, then I'm all for it as well.
Okay.
Like Michael Ward, I wouldn't be against that.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
All right. Nice. You answered my question. Thank you very much.
I'm saying just in case you want to write a scene for me, Michael, that's fair.
It might already be happening.
Wow. You see, guys, maybe you never know what's going to happen. You never know. Well, that's the end of the interview.
Cool.
It's been nice chatting to you.
I feel better now. I was scared in the beginning. I ain't gonna lie.
So you see, when I told you I was scared, he's just like, oh, really? But really, why does everyone like have this thing that I'm gonna come in like a bull in a
shop? Do you know what it is? It was my heart and my instinct. So you remember I shouted you?
Yeah.
And I was like, your show's dope, whatever. Yeah. And you were like, ah, you should come in or whatever. And I was like, Yeah, but I don't want to be treated like them people sort of thing.
Yeah, but this is, I think people always know, like, if I have, like, a really, which is really bad, it's not, I shouldn't say this maybe, but if I have, like, a high respect for somebody, even though I might disagree, like I said, I don't necessarily agree with the stereotypes in Top Boy, but I still have a respect for you because of what you've done for the scene, how you've managed to transition, you know, go from what the negative and then, like, literally, you know, everyone rates you as like an actor, as a musician. Do you get what I'm saying? And that's hard to do. Do you get what I mean? Especially mainstream acting as well. So I have to, that I can't not respect that. Do you get what I mean? So there's always going to be that level of like, oh, you know, niceness.
Okay.
But I'm still going to ask questions that I've always kind of wanted to know. Like, how was it filming the sex scene in Bullet Boy? I mean, that was probably one of the questions you think I wasn't going to ask.
Yeah, maybe, yeah, I didn't know that was coming. Yeah. It was quite left.
So it was quite left, wasn't it?
But listen, I appreciate you.
Thank you.
In your kid gloves and whatever.
In my what?
I said, I appreciate you and your kid gloves.
Kid
you?
Gloves, what's that?
It's a metaphor for taking it easy on me.
Oh, okay. Fair enough.
It's a 38-year-old thing, isn't it?
Oh, I'm 31, you know. No. I'm not that younger than you.
That's 7 years.
I know, but I'm still like in the 30 bracket.
Do you remember Thundercats?
I mean, I wasn't really a cartoon
person.
Right,
well, there you go. That's what I'm saying. That's what them 7 years mean. All right? Where's my cab?
All right, guys, you know what to do. Like, subscribe, tell your friends, tell your family, tell your mom, your dad. Thank you for coming on.
Thank you.
It's been fun. Peace.